Hello everyone, welcome to this session of Cashless Consumers Payment Deep Dives. We'll be looking at ATMs and Cashonomics. I'm Srikant, part of Cashless Consumer, a consumer collective working on digital payments and all things payments. So we'll be looking at an overview of ATMs, how they work, what's the regulations around ATMs. And then on the recently released ATM interchange committee report, which focuses on the interchange pricing or basically the cost of ATM charges and so on. So we'll be looking deep into cost of cash and pricing of ATMs, followed by a discussion. What are we going to see and understand about ATMs today? We'll basically go through a one full cycle of who are all the players involved in making sure that you get the cash from the ATM. So that will be a range of players. We'll understand the entire operations of ATM and see who are all involved and what role do they play. And then we'll have a brief overview of the ATM payments technology, which broadly is classified into three sections. One is the machine itself, and then the card networks, and then the ATM networks. And then we'll look into some of the data that's out there available on ATMs in India. And finally, we'll look into ATM regulations, pricing, and the policy aspects. So these are the four pillars of cashless consumer, as you may be aware. So it will be awareness, technology, data, and policy. So first we'll see how does ATM serve you cash, or this is basically a larger life cycle of cash in general. So first you have a press or a mint, which prints the currency, and then that is then transported into what is called as currency chests. In the case of coins, they are called as small coin depots. From where it is again further transported into vaults of the banks or in some cases cash management agencies. From where again it is then distributed into bank branches, some white labeled ATM operators. We look at what white labeled ATM operators are, and then some business correspondents who would then reach out to the end consumer, which is you and I, having a debit card. We would use any of these channels. Like you go to a bank and withdraw cash, or an ATM, which could be a bank's ATM or a third-party operator ATM. Or we may use business correspondent to get that cash. And that cash gets circulated among the population, and at some point it reaches the bank branches. From where again it either get recycled again through the same chain, or it goes back to the vaults and they get soiled in case of damage. So this is basically a broad life cycle of cash, the currency notes in general. And let's look at the intermediaries involved in this process. So in India, we have the press or the mint, both private limited companies of RBI itself. So the notes that we all get are printed by Bharatiya Reserve Bank Note Mudran Private Limited, and all the coins are minted in SPAMCIL. And then it comes to the banks, which have vaults. So this will be like a large regional vault of a bank where the cash is kind of stored. In this process, you also have cash transit agencies who have specially armored vehicles for transiting cash, which has special tracking requirements and security protocols. And the people involved also as part of the security services to ensure that the cash is safe. So there are two agencies here which get involved in movement of cash physically on the road. One being the cash and transit agency, and then the security services. And then when we use an ATM, it's typically the own bank's ATM, or in some cases we would use some other bank's ATM, but an ATM that is part of a network. So in this case, in India, there are three large networks that are functional right now. There have been multiple networks in the past, but these are the only three ones that are still standing alive. So one is the National Financial Switch. This is the ATM network operated by NPCI in India, and pretty much 99% of all the ATMs in India are connected to this ATM network, and they process roughly around like 90 to 95% of all interbank transactions that happen on the ATMs. And then there is another ATM network called CashNet, which is operated by Euronet. This is largely used by foreign banks in India for them to support their customers. But with the advent of card networks, it really does not matter now, because card networks provide that interoperability to the end consumer. But these ATM networks function as a means for banks to have their commercial agreements between each other, and each of these ATM networks have their own role in that sense to ensure that the business aspects of ATM operations when it comes to interoperability are handled by the ATM networks. And then we have the SBI ATM network itself, which powers right now only the SBI, but a while back it was SBI plus other state bank group of banks. And then we have card networks, so these are like Visa, MasterCard, RuPay, Amex, Diners, this JCB and Union Pay as well. So but in India, I think predominantly the card issuance is on Visa, Master and RuPay for debit cards. So these ensure that the card that you are having are interoperable in any ATMs that support these card networks, and pretty much all the ATMs in India support all these card networks. And that's again partly a function that all the ATMs are part of the NFS network, and whatever the NFS network supports, all the ATM supports. And then there are machines, the ATM machines, physically the ATM machines. Major player is NCR, then there's Hitachi Payments. These are entities that manufacture, service the physical ATM machines, OEMs, which take care of the machine from a physical delivery standpoint. And there are like and some OEM operators also take care of servicing the ATMs in terms of like security patches and so on. And then there is your bank or some other bank, which actually gives you the debit card and the bank and the ATM of the bank with which you go and take out the cash. So when it comes to tech, there are three machine types. One is the standard ATMs are basically cash dispensers. So you put in your debit card, or credit card, and they dispense cash. And this is the most popular cash ATM type that is out there. But then there are also cash deposit machines where you can deposit cash and you'll get an acknowledgement. And whenever the ATM gets cleared, which is roughly 2 to 3 days, and more so maybe in case of every day, in the case of a bank-based ATM, and your deposit will then be processed and settled into your account. And then there are cash recycler machines. So these are the newer breed of machines where the cash deposited into the machine also kind of gets through out into the dispensing mode. So this has a significant advantage in terms of operational cost for the banks, because whatever the customer deposit kind of recycled into dispensing mode as well automatically without any manual intervention. Mostly these are used in the branches where ATMs that are attached to the branches, so that the bank staff at the end of the day can just put in extra cash and then without like manually say opening the back end of the place. And they can also route people who want to deposit cash on the branch into these recycler machines, so that the recycler's machine kind of automatically acts as a deposit taking, and there's no need to refill these ATMs. And coming to the features, there are also, we've been quite used to touch ATMs for a while now, but there are also talking ATMs, and there are also ATMs that come with biometric support. A note on this, sometime in 2016, RBI mandated all ATMs that are going to be newly deployed from 2017 have to support Aadhaar, the biometric authentication mode. And so there is like quite a set of ATMs in the country which now has biometric support. But then this never was rolled out for various reasons, including issues around biometrics and Aadhaar hardware authentication, which subsequently got changed after a replay attack in 2017. And this kind of led to use of biometrics in or use of Aadhaar based biometrics in India at least to a standstill. But it is still possible that the newer ATMs can probably use, say, facial recognition techniques, and if your bank has your facial profile, you might soon probably have facial auth as part of the ATM itself. And the newer versions of the ATMs, they do come up with a camera and the ATM itself, besides the ones in the overall room. And on the operating system, the ATM uses, traditionally Windows XP has been the most used operating system, and subsequent higher versions of Windows. But recently, a lot of these ATM manufacturers have started deploying Android and have started using light OS-based thin client on the ATM, and a thin client which connects to a cloud, so which kind of reduces the hardware requirements at the client side when it comes to, say, compute and OS performance. So you just have a thin client and which connects to a cloud server. So what does ATM network operation mean? So we most of us are aware of the card networks. We all have a debit card or credit card, and we do know quite some knowledge about how these card networks work between issuers and the merchants. The role of card networks is the same as what it is in the case of a merchant transaction, except that it happens on an ATM. But there are other ATM networks, and their role involves doing interbank settlement, taking care of disputes, chargebacks, and putting through a retrieval framework for issues around the use of ATM, like card getting stuck inside ATM or cash not dispensed and so on. They also provide the value-added services on the ATM itself. This could be like bill payments, balance check, or a credit card bill payment. And in India, of course, we had Aadhaar seeding as well through ATM. This is basically any service that can connect to the bank's interface using a common ATM as a channel. And we've also had cardless ATMs for almost a decade now. This is basically a mobile transfer where a person who has a bank account can transfer some amount of money. I think there are limits to it, but some amount of money to a mobile number, which will have an OTP, and then the person having the mobile number can just go to that particular bank's ATM and then punch in their OTP and get cash, all without a card. Recently, there have been some efforts around using UPI as a authentication mode or a transaction platform for the ATM to dispense cash. when it comes to security, we've had the infamous Hitachi debit card hack that happened in sometime in 2015, if I remember right, which is basically 32 million debit card details were compromised due to a malware attack on the Hitachi ATMs. That's the most that we know about this attack. There was some sort of investigation and a penalty that was put on Hitachi, and then the case was closed. And there is also another larger attack, which is called the Cosmos Bank hack, in which fraudsters used duplicate ATM cards and used a nifty bug in the Cosmos Bank's settlement system, which basically meant that they could withdraw money without their balance getting debited or something of that sort. So that was another larger attack. There were stories about how this was linked to some Korean hacker group and so on. And then, of course, there are like ATM incidents, you know, people barging in ATM and trying to destroy machines and kind of steal cash and all sorts of things. I mean, there are now people seeing YouTube videos and then going into ATMs and trying all sorts of crazy things. So now we'll look into some data about ATMs. So India has roughly 2,34,000 ATMs. RBI puts in this quarterly statistics of ATMs in the country, and they do put by bank, by metro, semi-urban, urban, rural, public sector, private sector banks, payment banks, white label ATMs. So white label ATMs are basically private entities which are not banks, but they do partner with banks and take some cash. They are connected to these ATM networks. So their role is basically to deploy the ATMs and manage and operate these ATMs. So in places where there are too few customers for a single particular bank and the banks are unwilling to deploy ATMs, white label ATM providers go and deploy and manage them. So that was the concept of white label ATM networks. And because once you connect your ATM to a ATM network, and an ATM network like say the NFS, which has pretty much the entire coverage of all the Indian banks, means that that ATM becomes usable for anybody. So these are the ATMs that you often see in villages along highways where there are no specific banks, but these private entities deploy these ATMs. There's Tata, which is like a biggest provider, and then there is Hitachi, and then Wakangri, and so on. So RBI puts this details about the number of ATMs split by bank, and they also have a split by bank and by state. If I can zoom in, so this probably will give you a much detailed breakup of where banks are deploying, where banks are shutting down ATMs at a quarterly level. Then there is data from NPCI on the transaction volumes on the NFS. This NFS volumes only mean that these are transactions that have happened on the interbank route. So if you're probably taking cash from your own bank, they don't pass through NFS. But if you for people who are doing interbank ATM transactions, they most certainly pass through NFS in India. And they do put out statistics of NFS monthly. Now we'll also we are releasing a list of 84,000 ATMs and their details. So that is now available on Cashless Consumers website. I'll be sharing the link in the blog post later today. So this basically has a set of 84,000 ATMs and their locations, their address, which bank, and some ATM metadata around whether they are part of, whether they're inside the bank or outside the bank, and they're like rural, urban, and whether they support biometrics, braille, parking ATM, or accessibility features, and their availability, their location. So this set of data for 84,500 ATMs is now available publicly. So we'll then look into the policy aspects of ATMs. So ATMs are governed under the Payments and Settlement Systems Act of 2007. So RBI manages the ATMs and provides regulatory guidelines around pretty much a whole host of things around ATM operations, be it from cash in transit regulations to security, cyber security regulations to pricing. We will come into the pricing bit in a while. And then there are also additional home ministry guidelines related to physical security, because these ATMs and ATM operations involve movement of large amount of cash, which can potentially be a security issue, physical security issue. Home Ministry also provides these guidelines. So typically, the security guard who comes as part of the ATM cash in transit plan has a loaded gun and is trained to use that. So these are some of the regulatory guidelines around movement of cash. And ATMs were primarily seen as a way to kind of reduce bank staff in the sense that you kind of automate that portion, that function of the bank of cash disbursement with a machine. So banks were like staffed heavily, and because there were no new recruitments for the older staff getting retired in most of the public sector banks. So the ATMs were kind of seen as the place where some portion of the work of the banks get automated. So, and they were a significant amount of investment by almost all the banks into putting up ATMs, and because they were considered as savings. What happened subsequently was there was a policy decision of allowing private entities to own, operate, manage ATMs. So these are called white label and brown label ATM operators. So the difference being, white label operators like say Tata IndiCash, they own that ATM right from the machine. They rent the premise and they manage the ATM by loading cash and maintaining cash in them. So it's basically a private ATM which connects to the same ATM network. So anybody can use that ATM, and the bank of the user then pays this white label ATM operator a fixed interchange fee for their customer to use their this ATM. And this fee traditionally has been like a per transaction fee. It's like 12 to 15 rupees per transaction. So even though your transactions for an end consumer is free, the bank pays 12 to 15 rupees to this white label ATM operator, or even any other ATM operator if you're doing an interbank ATM transaction. And brown label ATM operators are basically entities that take over the capex of ATMs from the bank, but they act as a managed service provider for maintaining that ATM, and the bank no longer maintains the ATM, and they brown label ATM operators charge the bank per transaction. And this was primarily seen as a vehicle for getting more investment into the ATM industry and growing ATM industry, because it was felt that only banks investing in ATM will not actually make ATMs penetrate to the nook and corner of the country. But what has happened over the last decade is that we have not seen active growth in this, because the investors are not actually seeing a viable business model in running these. And this is probably one of the reasons why the interchange committee itself was formed to kind of revise these interchange rates, so that it becomes more profitable for these entities to kind of invest in this business. So we've seen like kind of a stagnation in deployment of ATMs for almost last 5 years. And this is despite probably like 10x, 20x growth in terms of number of accounts. So we now have the Jan Dhan Yojana accounts, but the number of ATMs have pretty much remained stagnant, or in some cases, there's also been a slight degrowth, if one may say, in the last couple of years. So with this, we'll come to the pricing issue and cost of cash. So where did this cost of cash kind of come up? So the first initial references to this term appeared in a paper released by Better Than Cash Alliance, exploring digital payments and what is the cost of cash on an economy, and how one needs to kind of move away from cash to digital payments to reduce the cost of cash. And this was kind of primarily seen from the lens of the banks as well as the states. And the cost of cash is usually borne by these two parties. And they kind of, and the push to digital payments itself was primarily due to the fact that how do banks in the countries reduce this cost of cash, which has direct economic consequences for them, and how do they nudge people into digital payments, which is far more cheaper for both the banks as well as the state. But in this talk, we'll kind of limit our focus into the ATM pricing in India. So brief look at ATM pricing in India. We kind of had ATMs from 90s. Initially, it was only debit card. It was initially it was only an ATM card and not a debit card. Not much of it was a ATM card issued by a specific banks. Banks did not even join the card networks. Slowly at the start of 2000s, they started joining the card networks, which meant that for the first time, it is cards are kind of made interoperable. And in an interoperable scenario, you pay the interchange as determined by the network. So we started having charges for interbank ATM transactions, which went as high as 40 to 50 rupees in early 2000s. And this was then further rationalized, and there was a RBI draft on fair pricing of ATMs in 2008, which went into a greater level of detail into analyzing the cost structures of managing ATMs, and then came out with a pricing regulation, if one may say so, and put a price cap on ATM charges. And this price cap is what we still have today. And this is like 17 rupees a transaction plus taxes. And further, subsequently in 2009, after the start of NFS, which meant that a lot of banks are now available on NFS, and the degree of interoperability kind of drastically changed in 2009, which meant that RBI kind of went ahead further and said, there'll be a set of free transactions for everybody, and everybody will get 5 free transactions in an ATM. And this was subsequently revised in 2014, where RBI said, except in 5 cities, 6 cities in India, other places will have 5, and these metro cities, that's the phrase that RBI used, will have 3 free transactions. So that was revised in 2014. And what's not often talked about is the cost of demonetization for these cash industries, so which we've seen the entire value chain of players involved in cash, and it pretty much affected everybody. So, and each one of them had to take a cost due to demonetization. And there are also other kind of costs that kept on getting added into the ATMs. These include, let's say, the new 100 rupee note. There is a report which says that the 100 rupee note that's newly designed is actually costing the entire ATM industry to the tune of 100 crores to kind of replace, because they cannot have the old and new 100 rupee notes together on the same ATM, and for one to move into the newer ones, it costs the entire industry an amount of 100 crores. And there are also 7 other regulations put in bank time by RBI, including how the cash and transit vehicles have to be moved around, and when and how long can they load. There's a infamous regulation called the cassette regulation, which meant that cash has to be loaded only from pre-packaged ATM cassettes, and not which basically means that the person refilling the ATM cannot kind of put in any money from his or her own pocket and fill in that ATM, and which means that the pre-packaged bundle of notes has to come from a central vault, and the vault needs to ensure that the set of notes are packaged into these cassettes, and the person refilling the ATMs will just switch these cassettes. And this meant that the cassette, this is infamously called the cassette regulation of the RBI, which meant that which is still not enforced completely, and RBI said it is planning to enforce the cassette regulation strictly, but there are talks between the industry stakeholders, because this adds a direct cost to these industry, which kind of boiled down to this ATM interchange committee. So in last July was when RBI in its monetary policy announced the formation of this ATM interchange committee, which comprised of the IBA, NPCI, and a couple of banks and few non-bank white label ATM operators on the committee. And they kind of sat and deliberated on the interchange structure and even the charges, pricing and charges that are charged to the end consumer. And they came up with this report sometime in October. But for some strange reason, this committee report was never released. And this is what we kind of recently accessed through RTI and put the report in public domain. And we'll see what this report talks of briefly. Firstly, there were problems with the committee composition itself, because the entire committee was comprised of industry stakeholders, and there is nobody from consumer or the civil society who are the users of these ATMs in the committee. So it was entirely an industry driven approach to determine the pricing and interchange as against to a all multi-stakeholder participation. And then there was no transparency about the committee, and there's no reason why this committee report itself was not put out. And moving on to the report itself and what I see as the issues in the report, one thing the committee has done in great level of detail is to actually list down what are the various cost structures involved in an ATM. This include the rent for the premises, the operation costs that are fixed for the ATM, say rent, electricity, and security. And then there are OPEX costs, which basically vary by the level of replenishment of these ATMs and how much transactions take place every day in those ATMs. And roughly, the average stats says that the average rent across India is 20,000 for an ATM, there are like 120 withdrawals per day across any ATM in India. And these are like average numbers, so there'll be far more extremes depending on which ATM you look at. And so they kind of broken down that and said for any transaction, it would obviously, the cost of operations would kind of boil down to something like 20 to 24 rupees, up from current 12 to 15 rupees. And this is the interchange rate that's not charged to the consumer, but paid by the bank of the user to the ATM operator, which could be another bank or these private white labeled operators. So the interchange revision was the key agenda for this committee, because that was not revised for like around 10 years now, and whereas there have been various rising costs, including fuel, transportation, and on top of which these RBI regulations and security regulations around movement of cash has imposed further increased cost on these entities to manage these ATMs. So there was a proposal to revise the cost, but one problem I see in that is that the numbers that are quoted by the various banks, and there's one set of numbers quoted by costs that are incurred by SBI, costs that are incurred by other public sector banks, costs that are incurred by private sector banks, and these are like put in as a rough uniform number for the entire country, which is probably not the right way to look at, because there will be variances across, say, demographics, but this was not considered when it came to pricing. So it's probably very cheaper to kind of have an ATM in a city with dense population, or say in a mall where the number of transactions are so high, as opposed to say having them in a remote college campus where the population, the user base is pretty much fixed, and the frequency of transactions is going to be very limited. But this committee in its deliberations kind of noted the costs as uniformly across public sector, private sector banks, instead of going through nitty-gritties of what it actually costs. And in its recommendation, besides recommending an increase of the interchange, it also said to put a cap on the free transaction limit, and said anything above 5,000 rupees should be charged, without actually going into what the impact on economy is, because we are still largely a cash-based society. And if this was a way to kind of push the cashless options or push people into digital payments, there are serious consequences about it, because we still don't have a replacement of cash in very many scenarios. The current digital payment options, despite them being there at an increasingly higher rate, we still don't have them for all use cases. And more importantly, there are some pitfalls of digital payments in which can't be used in certain contexts, and cash is essential. And we are, of course, speaking about a country which is like very wide in demographics, literacy, age, digital aware, literacy, and so on. So there are multiple factors in saying in limiting availability of cash, or putting an artificial cost on cash, if I say so. And the other thing that the committee recommended is from the current definition of metro, which is just the five or six top cities in India, they kind of expanded that to million plus population cities, which works around to be like 60 odd cities in India. And these cities will have only three free transactions instead of five. And while the committee said they will increase the number of free transactions in the rural areas, there is no clear roadmap for increasing rural penetration and how this interchange revision will help in creation of more infrastructure in the rural India. And there was another touchy point on e-surveillance. Basically, one of the costs for the ATM operators is to have a security guard. And a note was said we'll move this into an e-surveillance, and we can replace the security guard with the CCTV camera and so on, which potentially has an issue related to loss of jobs. And so what was missed in this committee is there was while there was a focus on documenting the pricing at the existing standards, which meant that the footfalls remained at 120 per day and how frequently ATMs are getting used at what pace. There was no focus on increasing withdrawals and deposit inside these ATMs, which would have meant that more specifically, if one were to kind of use mandate use of cash recyclers and encourage people into deposits, the cost of replenishment automatically comes down. But this was somehow not considered as part of this committee. There was also no talk about improvement in optimization of logistics cost. With all this technology and innovation, there is no discussion around what can be done to kind of further optimize the cost, let's say using route planning in terms of movement of cash and so on. There is also no talk about using other services through ATMs and pricing. I mean, this could be something like, you know, you could go and reset your Gmail password using ATM and charge people for it. And there would be people who probably have will use such a service. And these kind of alternate service delivery options are not being thought about through ATMs, which can act as a important touch point for an authentication of a critical transaction, even outside the context of banking. And this probably can be a revenue source for ATMs, but there is no thinking around these areas of expansion and using the infrastructure for something like, or even say an Aadhaar address update and so on. But the other thing that was not talked about is how do we mandate issuers who issue debit cards to deploy ATMs correspondingly to their issuance. Because the problem of lack of ATMs is basically that the smaller banks which kind of issue debit cards are not deploying additional number of ATMs. So there has to be some kind of a mandate which says that you need to have, if you have issued X million debit cards, you need to have Y proportion of that in ATMs, and you need to generate that much number of ATM transactions. So it kind of becomes a responsibility for the bank to have a proportional investment of the customer acquisition that they do, and not just free riding on somebody else, which is probably a larger bank, which is put in the infrastructure. And what was also not kind of discussed is if we treat payments infrastructure as a public good, and there is a recent RBI announcement on something called as Payment Infrastructure Development Fund, with which they will kind of provide grants for deploying POS infrastructure into rural India. But what was not thought about is using a similar kind of fund or a grant-based approach to kind of fill the gap of viability of ATMs in rural India, and hence increasing the ATM penetrations, because now, since financial inclusion is a policy goal of the government, it has to kind of use the infrastructure and has to support the infrastructure development. And probably such a fund would have kind of given some thrust instead of kind of just passing on the cost and not talking about like improving the infrastructure in rural India. And what was also not talked about is the micro ATM pricing. So all this is only for the ATMs, which you and I who have debit cards use, but the poor who are partly relying or partly or fully relying on the government benefits, including the Jan Dhan Yojana and their subsidies getting credited in the account, they still don't have access to ATMs because they don't have access to debit cards in the first place. And even if they have debit cards in some cases, there is no ATM in that village. And they still access cash using what is known as the micro ATM or the business correspondence model, where an agent of the bank kind of comes in and delivers cash and performs transactions. And this is still unregulated in terms of pricing, and the pricing is market determined. So they pay a lot more than us. So at least we have like 3 free transactions. But a person in rural India is probably paying like 15 rupees to withdraw 1,000 rupee subsidy from the government. And this is not still regulated by RBI. So this is something that was missed by the committee. And with that, I've come to the end. I'll open it up for questions. Are there any questions in the YouTube chat? I think there are some people watching on YouTube. So if there are no other questions, and I think we've come to the end. So we'll wrap it now. Thanks for joining us. And another announcement is we have our next session on digital payments. So there's a question on the chat. Okay, so please expand a bit on the disparity between the urban and rural charges. It's a question from Rohan. So in case of ATMs itself, firstly, the rural India is not served by the traditional banks by large, and we could probably do some kind of filtering on the data that we got. And this is not the entire set of data, but probably an active subset, and probably like 1/3 of it. So if we see of the 84,000 ATMs, the number of rural ATMs, if we say, is 20,000. So roughly only 1/4 of the ATMs are in the rural side. And this is including the white labeled operators, who are the larger section of ATM deployers on the rural side. And this greatly affects the access to ATM itself. It's unlike in cities where we can kind of move around. It's largely like one ATM per village or one ATM per block, and people have to kind of travel into these to get access to this. So this is basically the large challenge that is facing us, is kind of this growth has not trickled down to the rural India. And this ATM deployment is again one such classic use case. Classic example of how the growth has not kind of moved in, and what has been supplemented with the current infrastructure is the business correspondent model, where people are asked to use these with the banking agents who come to the village and use the same Aadhaar enabled payment system, so where people use their biometric and Aadhaar to kind of withdraw cash. And in some cases, you know, the local Kirana shop in the village acts as a cash out point using pretty much the same system, or in some cases they have a POS. There is also a cash at POS that is being tried, which also has a cost. So you can kind of use your debit card at a Kirana store in some places and withdraw cash up to say 2,000 or 5,000 and pay that shop 10 rupees, and they do give that if they have that cash. And this is probably so the first difference when it comes to rural and urban divide is in terms of access. And in terms of pricing, though the current committee has increased the number of free withdrawals, but it's kind of pointless, because firstly, there are no ATMs there, and people are using systems outside of what is governed under the ATM regulations. So they're probably either using the business correspondent for the Aadhaar enabled payment system, or the cash at POS at a Kirana store to withdraw. And in both these cases, they pay a charge. And the micro ATM charges are not governed by the ATM interchange guidelines issued by RBI. And this I have confirmed through an RTI from RBI itself, and RBI, as it stands, does not regulate pricing for the Aadhaar-enabled payment system or cash at cost. To give an example, this is like saying TRAI will regulate 4G price, but TRAI will not regulate 2G price, something like that of that sort. And it does seem like quite unfair because the ones the rural will have to pay more because they're not even getting, they're firstly not having ATMs in place, and they're not having the concept of free transactions that we have in cities.
Are there any other questions? If not, I'll wait for any other questions. Okay, so if not, I think I'll check the YouTube page. So Rohan B asked on YouTube. I hope I answered that. If there are no more questions, I'll quickly update on the next session. So the next session will be on July 11th. We'll be having a paper presentation titled The New Era for Credit Scoring. This is work done by Tarunima Prabhakar on a white paper for Center for Long-Term Cybersecurity, UC Berkeley. So where she looks into financial inclusion, data security and privacy in the context of digital lending. She's done a study detailing the digital lending apps and their methodologies and their issues in fairness, privacy, security, use of personal data. And so we'll be having her present her paper, and then we'll following that, we'll have a discussion by Penny Chug of Dwara and Praneet of Cashless Consumer to kind of discuss that paper, and then we'll have audience Q&A. So this is on the next fortnight, so July 11th, we'll be meeting again. With that, I will close for today. Thank you for joining. Bye.